Welcome to the Methuen Memorial Music Hall. It's better with the microphone. Hello. Welcome to the Methuen Memorial Music Hall, the home of the great organ. I'm Matthew Bellacchio, one of the Music Hall trustees. We hope that all of you are staying safe and well. This is the 12th program in our 15-week series. We'd like to thank our sponsors whose generous support has made this year's recital series possible. This program is sponsored by William H. Drury. And we invite you, our viewers, to visit our website, mmmh.org, and click on the donate link to help support the Music Hall. Another way you can help us is to invite your friends and family to watch these videos and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Subscribers are notified about new events and videos. So far, we have about 730 subscribers, and we'd like to get this up to 1,000 before the season ends. So please subscribe and spread the word. Thank you. Tonight's performer, Stephen Young, has a personal connection with many of the pieces on tonight's program. He's recorded a CD of organ works by Boston area composer Henry Dunham, and he has researched and published articles on some of the early 20th century French organists and composers whose works he's playing tonight. He will tell us about the pieces. Tomorrow, August 6th, is the 100th anniversary of the death of Edward F. Searles, who rescued the great organ and built this beautiful hall to house it. To mark this anniversary, Stephen will open his recital with a piece entitled In Memoriam that was dedicated to Edward Searles. The composer, Henry Morton Dunham, was a friend of Searles and was the organist for the funeral of Searles' wife in July of 1891. Dunham subsequently composed In Memoriam and dedicated it to Searles. It's a slow and solemn piece. Near the end, the tune of the hymn Lead Kindly Light appears. This hymn was one of Mrs. Searles' favorites and was played at her funeral. Though it was very popular 100 years ago, this hymn has fallen out of favor and disappeared from most modern hymnals. Therefore, Stephen will play the hymn tune, Lux Benigna, before the piece, so you can recognize it when it enters. Before we begin, the Music Hall Board of Trustees would also like to remember one of our longtime recital sponsors, who is now in a brighter light on a distant shore. We are very sad to announce that Richard A. Kenny, who sponsored this season's opening recital, died from COVID-19 last Friday, July 31st. Richard was a regular attendee at the summer recitals and will be greatly missed. May light perpetual shine on him. The hymn, Lead Kindly Light, was written by St. John Henry Newman, an English theologian, priest, and poet. The words of the first verse are, Lead kindly light amid the encircling gloom, lead thou me on. The night is dark, and I am far from home. Lead thou me on. Keep thou my feet. I do not ask to see the distant scene. One step enough for me. We hope you enjoy this program. I'll see you at intermission.
Thank you. Good evening.
And thank you for spending some time tonight with the great organ of the Methuen Memorial Music Hall. I am reading my remarks tonight because as a teacher with a microphone, it's a very dangerous combination. This will keep me honest. The first half of tonight's program focuses on German composers of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Richard Bartmuß spent much of his career in northern Germany, and the influence of his early predecessors, especially Buxtehude and Bach, are evident in this Prelude and Fugue. Karl Hoyer was a student of the great German organist Karl Straube, and he also studied with Max Reger. Hoyer's Meditation comes from a set of three pieces which comprise Opus 39. The opening lyrical melody is slightly tinged with some dissonant harmony. The midsection builds to a dramatic climax before returning to the opening material. Josef Rheinberger needs little introduction to organists. He composed 20 wonderful sonatas for the instrument. This sonata's second movement will be familiar to any organ aficionado. The last movement employs a type of cyclicism where material previously heard is reworked into the final fugue, helping give unity to the composition.
Thank you.
Wow, what a great fugue. Since tonight we're commemorating the centennial of Edward Searles' death, this is a good occasion to talk about how Searles came to acquire the great organ. In 1881, Henry Lee Higginson, a wealthy Bostonian, started and financed the Boston Symphony Orchestra, which performed and rehearsed in the Boston Music Hall, which housed the great organ. To ensure that the orchestra would have a permanent home there, Higginson purchased the controlling interest in the shares of the music hall. As the orchestra grew in popularity and size, it needed more space on the music hall stage. Since the organ was in poor mechanical shape by then and not often used, Higginson figured that removing it from the hall would make more room for the orchestra. Higginson arranged for the great organ to be sold for $5,000 to William O. Grover, a wealthy trustee of the New England Conservatory. Grover co-owned the Grover and Baker Sewing Machine Company and held several important sewing machine patents. He intended to eventually donate the organ to the New England Conservatory once it had built a concert hall capable of housing it. In 1884, the organ was disassembled by the Hutchings Organ Company and stored in a large shed that was specifically constructed for it behind the conservatory. The great organ was still in storage there 12 years later, in 1896, when William Grover died. The New England Conservatory had not yet built a concert hall and was, by that time, planning on moving to a new location. But the organ was still owned by Grover, and his heirs decided to auction it off to settle his estate. Organist Henry Morton Dunham, who composed the In Memoriam piece which opened tonight's program, was a good friend of Edward Searles. In his 1931 autobiography, The Life of a Musician, Dunham relates Searles' own account of how he came to buy the great organ. Now, in this account, Ingram is organ builder John Ingram, who oversaw the Methuen Organ Company, which Searles owned and financed. The organ factory occupied the site that is now the music hall parking lot. So here's Searles' account. I saw in the papers that the great organ was to be sold at auction by the heirs of the Grover estate. The result of that would be that it would be dismembered, scattered over the country, and its identity lost. It was difficult for me to imagine such a contingency, and I told Ingram that he might go and bid on it. When Ingram asked me how high he could bid, I said, without giving it any thought, for I had no expectation of getting it, $5,000. And then the whole matter slipped from my mind until a few days later when Ingram came to the house. The subject reoccurred to me and I said, well, who got the organ? You did, sir. Much surprised and rather dismayed, I asked, and how much do I pay? $1,500. Surely, cheap enough. But now I had a white elephant on my hands, however. However, I had it transported to my factory, and when upon unpacking it, we found everything in excellent condition, I decided to set it up and also give it a decent home. And this is the result. So, there you have it, in Searles' own words. And what a home he gave it. We hope you enjoy the second half of this program, and stay safe and well.
The second portion of the program takes us to France in the same time period as the first half. All of these composers studied in Paris. Édouard Comet completed his training under Charles-Marie Vidor and settled in Lyon, where he spent his career. He composed a small corpus of organ works, but this scherzo shows both the influence of Vidor and the early signs of modern harmony. Sorry, I'm told to put the mic closer to my mouth. Martha Brachmann is the only female composer on tonight's program. She is also the most daring of the composers featured. Her variations were composed in the mid-1930s and reflect the changing styles of music with her free use of dissonance and her colorful registrations. Alois Klausmann studied with Eugène Jagut, and like Comet, he left Paris to live and work in Clermont-Ferrand. Klausmann composed a large body of work, but it remains little known. This pastoral is an example of program music, as in the middle of a lovely afternoon on a boat, a raging storm surges and subsides. But as is often the case, there are a few lingering clouds after the storm. The final work on the program is by Louis Vierne, whose 150th birthday will be celebrated this October. This movement is the opening of the Second Symphony, written shortly after his appointment to Notre Dame in Paris. In it, we hear the beginnings of what will become his unique style that develops throughout his career.
Thank you. What a tremendous performance. We thank Steve for bringing his talents to share with us all. Hi, my name is Chad Dow, and I'm the current president of the Board of Trustees here at the Methuen Memorial Music Hall. We're so excited to be able to present our scheduled season via live stream, and we hope you join us for as many performances as you can. If this is your first time with us, a very warm welcome. And for those who have joined us in the past, welcome back, and I hope you enjoyed the performance just as much as we did. And please do be sure to tell a friend, like, and subscribe our YouTube channel so that everybody can enjoy the upcoming performances. The Methuen Memorial Music Hall is so grateful for all of our generous donors who have helped us during this challenging time. If you'd like to consider a donation, please visit our website at www.mmmh.org and look for the donate link. Thank you so much for your continued support and generosity. Be safe, stay well, and we hope to see you next time.